Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Martin Phillipson. I'm the Dean of Law. I'd like to welcome you to the Human Rights in the 21st Century, honoring the Honorable Erwin Kotler, PCOC. Thank you for attending what is sure to be the kickoff to a wonderful conference. As we gather here today, we acknowledge we're on Treaty 6 territory and the homeland of the Métis people. We pay our respect to the First Nation and Métis ancestors of this place and reaffirm our relationship with one another. At this point, I'd like to thank our planning committee and like them sort of identify themselves. Paul Finkelman, Ariel F. Salo's chair in human rights law. Paul, there he is. David Katzman, human rights educator and mediator at the Saskatchewan Human Rights Commission. Professor Heather Haven, Associate Dean of Graduate Studies and Research in the College of Law. Heather. And last but definitely not least, Katie Riley, the Events Coordinator at the College of Law. The Ariel F. Salo's Chair at the College of Law was established in January 1979 when the late Ariel F. Salo's QC of North Battleford, Saskatchewan, signed a trust agreement ensuring the future establishment of a chair at the University of Saskatchewan. Mr. Salo's, who passed away in 1984, was a longtime member of the Saskatchewan legal profession, an alumnus of the university, and former member of the university senate. The Ariel F. Salo's Chair in Human Rights was the first endowed chair of human rights in any law school in Canada, and today supports courses and research in human rights at both the undergraduate and graduate level. Over the years, yes. Thank you to one of the former holders of the chair there for the round of applause. Over the years, the chair has been occupied by some of the leading scholars and workers in the field of human rights, both from Canada and abroad, including Professor Virginia Leary, who was the very first chair, Dr. Abdullah Ahmed Anaim from Sudan, Dr. Rebecca Wallace from the United Kingdom, Professor Penny Andrews, of now in South Africa, Dr. Marilou McFedrin, Mary Eberts, and Kim Pate, and others. And it's a list that Ariel F. Salo's would be proud of. And it's now my pleasure to welcome our current and the 17th Ariel F. Salo's chairholder in human rights, Professor Paul Finkelman. Professor Finkelman is an expert in constitutional history and constitutional law, the freedom of religion, the law of slavery, civil liberties, and the American Civil War, and issues surrounding baseball. You can ask him about that later. Wonderful stuff. He's the author of more than 200 scholarly articles and more than 40 books. His op-eds and shorter pieces have appeared in the New York Times, the Washington Post, USA Today, and the Huffington Post. He's been cited several times by the United States Supreme Court and is ranked as one of the most cited legal historians by Brian Leiter's Law School Rankings. Paul has been a wonderful addition to our faculty and has been a tireless booster for the college and the chair at his many speaking engagements in Canada, the United States, and beyond. I think at last count, he's published at least 7 or 8 articles while he's been here, and he will deliver the 2016 Ariel F. Salo's Lecture in Human Rights Law entitled Unjust Justices, the United States Supreme Court, the Problem of Slavery and Modern Human Rights at lunchtime on October the 17th. And I encourage you all to be in the MLT Lecture Theater in the college on October the 17th. But please join me in welcoming the 17th Ariel F. Salo's Chair in Human Rights, Professor Paul Finkelman.
Thank you, Martin. And I want to thank the University of Saskatchewan for being my host since January. I came here in January, and of course people said, why are you going to Saskatchewan in January? And I said, because I've always wanted to see what happens when Fahrenheit and Celsius meet, and of course they do here. It has been a delightful year. This is a spectacular university. I think the faculty and students often don't have the perspective of somebody who's been elsewhere to see just how terrific this place is. And so I really feel honored not only in holding the sales chair, but simply by being welcomed into your community. I would like to thank a few people as well before I begin, and I would like to thank Sarah Tieflick, who is our publicity person, who you will see running around here, shooting pictures of people. She's hiding over there with her camera on. I'd like to thank my colleague again, Heather Haven, who is our associate dean, and without her, it would have been impossible to put this conference on together at all. And again, David Katzman from the Human Rights Commission. And most of all, I want to give another thank you to Katie Riley, because for all of the speakers, you know, she is the one who figured out how to get you here, how to find a hotel for you, and dealt with all of your questions. And so I just want to thank you, Katie, for everything. I would also like to acknowledge a few people from the community who have gone the extra mile to help us. Most importantly, the Human Rights Commissioner for the province, Judge David Arnott, and Heather Fainis, who is a tireless worker in the community and a great supporter of human rights. And please let people know where you are. So I'm forcing you to stand or do something. Thank you. One of the great pleasures of having the podium is you can embarrass your friends, and it's always a joy to do it. I also want to welcome a few people. In addition to Commissioner Arnott, the provost of the university, Ernie Barber, is here, as is Sanjeev Anand, who was at one time a dean but has since been promoted to a judge. And so, again, the Honorable Sanjeev Anand, I thank you for coming tonight. A little bit about Irwin. I met Irwin in 2005 when I came here for a SALS conference. And he had come in, at that point he was the Attorney General and Minister of Justice for Canada. And at the time, the Attorney General in the United States was somebody named Adalberto Gonzalez, who spent most of his years in his office defending torture and defending military trials of civilians and defending attempts to eviscerate human rights wherever he could reach out to do so. And what I was struck by was first the title that Minister Kotler had. He was the Minister of Justice. His purpose was, in fact, to bring justice to people, as opposed to the title in the United States, which was the Attorney General. Essentially, his purpose was to prosecute people. And I always thought that that was a significant and important difference, not only between the two men, but also between the two countries. That is, I wish that my own country would look north to learn something about the purpose of a Minister of Justice. At the time, because I do in fact write on baseball and law and have spoken many times on the subject, at the time I suggested that we could trade Gonzalez for Kotler, and we could even send a player to be named later to Canada. But I could not get any Canadians to go along with this. And so Minister Kotler stayed here. He has been a tireless international advocate of human rights. If I were to list all the people who he has helped leave repressive, authoritarian nations, we would not have time for his talk. If I were to list all of the organizations that he has been involved in, whether it has been trying to find a just and honorable peace for all people connected to Israel and Palestine, whether it has been to bring refugees out of the Soviet Union, refugees out of Iran, refugees out of other totalitarian nations, Irwin Kotler is a man of international stature. And he is, of course, retired from politics, but of course, someone like Irwin never retires. He simply moves on to the next calling, the next task. And so his current calling is he is now the director of the new Raoul Wallenberg Center for Canada, where again, his focus is on fighting genocide, fighting totalitarian repression of people, and fighting for the human rights of all people in the world. More than my introduction, though, I now turn the podium over, in a sense, to a video introduction, because Ralph Goodale could not get here personally. But while he had to turn down our invitation, he wanted to introduce Irwin himself. And so I think if I ask, the lights will be dimmed and we can meet the Honorable Ralph Goodale. It's not every day that I get to virtually introduce a member of the cabinet.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's always a pleasure for me to take part in events at the University of Saskatchewan. And I'm especially pleased tonight to have this opportunity to welcome a former colleague and a great friend, Irwin Cotler, to our province and to my alma mater. For a Canadian conference on human rights, I can think of no more worthy honoree than Irwin. When he first became my colleague in the House of Commons back in 1999, he had already been named an officer of the Order of Canada, particularly for his work in human rights law, notably on behalf of political prisoners like Nelson Mandela in South Africa and Nathan Sharansky in the former Soviet Union. As a member of parliament, he continued advancing the causes of justice and human rights both in Canada and around the world in the midst of whatever else might be happening in Ottawa on any given day. Irwin could be counted on to rise in the chamber and remind us of what was going on in Darfur or in Syria, in Russia or Tibet. He championed the cases of political prisoners from China to Egypt, from Venezuela to Saudi Arabia, from Mauritania to Iran. And he recalled the lessons of the Holocaust and the genocide in Rwanda and other horrors of the past, with a view to ending those of the present and preventing others in the future. Perhaps less well known is the work that Irwin did domestically as Minister of Justice to promote rights and freedoms in this country. To give just a few examples, Irwin wrote Canada's first law specifically targeting human trafficking. He crafted the Canadian legislation granting marriage equality to same-sex couples, and he quashed more wrongful convictions in a single year as Minister of Justice than did any of his predecessors. Throughout, Irwin not only earned respect and indeed affection across party lines, he had a knack for recruiting members of all political parties to join in his human rights initiatives, passing unanimous resolutions, holding joint news conferences, and generally seeing to it that matters of human rights would be objects of consensus and not division. It was no accident that when he ended his farewell address in Parliament last year, the standing ovation on all sides of the House was long and loud and heartfelt. And it comes as no surprise to anyone who knows Irwin that since leaving the House of Commons, he has simply taken on more cases and more causes and more victims of injustice in need of a champion. As a human rights lawyer, as a law professor, as a member of parliament, as a minister, and now as founder and chair of the Raoul Rauhenberg Center for Human Rights, Irwin Cotler has always been that kind of champion. It has been my great privilege to be his colleague and his friend. And I'm happy to say that three members of my current ministerial staff, Marcy Serkis, Eloge Butera, and Michael Millick, are all former employees and colleagues of Irwin Cotler. His legacy continues. I wish you all a very productive conference on human rights in Saskatoon. I hope that those of you from out of town will enjoy this most beautiful province. And I invite you now to join me in welcoming to the University of Saskatchewan a great Canadian, a very good man, and a genuine citizen of the world, the Honorable Irwin Cotler.
Thank you, Minister Goodell. I give you my friend and someone who is truly, as the minister said, a true citizen of the world, Erwin.
Thank you, Paul. I'm really delighted to be able to be here and participate in the common cause which brings us together, the promotion and protection of human rights in the 21st century, and the role and responsibilities of each of us individually and collectively in that struggle. I want to express my appreciation to you, Paul, to the Dean, to all those associated with this evening and its organization and implementation. I have to say that the conference, as it turns out, is taking place at a very compelling moment, both in domestic terms and in international terms. Domestically, we are on the eve of the 35th anniversary of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, a revolutionary act which had a transformative impact not only on our laws, but on our lives, and I will speak to that issue. And it is also the 80th anniversary of the coming into effect of the Nuremberg race laws, which became prologue and precursor that took us down the road to the Holocaust and mass murder. And so they will be metaphors, really, for both the domestic and international inquiries that I hope to share with you this evening, and the lessons to be drawn from them, not only lessons learned, but the action to be taken. I want to also express thanks would be an understatement and an appreciation to Ralph Goodale for his really moving and humbling remarks. I take it to be the exaggeration and excesses of a good friend and colleague over the years. But to the extent that an honor has been accorded, I would take it to be in recognition of the cases and causes that I've had the privilege to be associated with over the years, in recognition of the political prisoners whose own cases and causes served as inspiration for me, and I should say for all of us in our work, and in recognition of my colleagues in academe, in the bench and bar, in government, in parliament, in civil society, with whom I had the pleasure all these years in working together in common cause. And not to be forgotten, my teachers over the years who educated me and nurtured me, beginning, I won't go through them, but beginning with my kindergarten teacher, because I have to say, had it not been for her, I would have been an early kindergarten dropout, and who knows what might have followed. So I always remember her particular nurturing intervention at a critical moment in the crossroads of my upbringing at the time. And my students, and Ralph mentioned them, the students who were my interns and who became my teachers. And certainly my wife and children who endured much of what I was doing over the years, but joined me in the trenches, though I have to say with respect to my wife, not always on the same side, but that allowed for that kind of dialectical encounter in the family area that produced a more informed and critical perspective with regard to the larger struggles for human rights. And perhaps most important, my parents of blessed memory. I always am reminded of their teachings, and tonight, maybe in particular, it happens to be the anniversary of my mother's passing exactly tonight. And so I recall that it was my father who taught me at a young age, before I could even appreciate the profundity of his remarks, when he would say to me and repeat the biblical injunction of justice, justice shall you pursue, and gave it to me in the Hebrew language as well, of tzedek, tzedek, tirdof, and reminding me that the word tzedek in Hebrew required at least three or four words in English or French or Arabic in order to find its approximation. And he said to me, this is what you must teach unto your children, and that this was to be my moral compass. But I have to say that it was my mother who, when she would hear my father saying these things to me, would say that if you want to pursue justice, you have to understand, you have to feel the injustice about you. You have to go in and about your community and beyond and feel the injustice and combat the injustice. Otherwise, the pursuit of justice will remain a theoretical abstraction. And so I suspect that as a result of these teachings of my parents and those others whom I associate with them in the development of those teachings, that I got involved in the two great human rights struggles of the second half of the 20th century. The struggle for human rights in the former Soviet Union and the struggle against apartheid in South Africa. And got involved with the people, the political prisoners, who became the face, the voice, the vision of those struggles. Anatoly Sharansky in the former Soviet Union and Nelson Mandela in South Africa, each of whom embodied the three great struggles in their own person in the second half of the 20th century, the struggle for freedom, as Nelson Mandela called, the long march towards freedom, the struggle for democracy, and the struggle for equality, and anchored always in each of their cases in the overarching struggle for peace. And so what I would like to do at this point is share with you some foundational principles which were imparted to me by all those whom I mentioned above and which underpin that moral compass of which I have spoken. The first lesson is the importance, indeed, I would say, the imperative of remembrance, le devoir de mémoire, as the French would put it, the duty of memory. And as I say, we meet in that sense at an important historical moment of not only remembrance and reminder, but of bearing witness and of taking action. Of the 80th anniversary of those Nuremberg race laws, which became not only the institutionalization of racism, the legalization of anti-Semitism, the precursor of what became and engulfed the world in the Holocaust, but where accompanying that promulgation was the indifference and the silence of the international community, let alone la trahison des clercs, the betrayal of the elites within Germany at the time. And we meet, as it happens, on the 75th anniversary to the day when in Babi Yar, 75 years ago, in 2 days, some 34,000 Jews were murdered in one of the fastest and most brutal killing fields in all of the Holocaust. And so we have not only the genocide of 6 million Jews, the mass murder of 11 million non-Jews, but we must never look at this in terms of abstract statistics. We must always remember, and in wherever mass atrocities find expression, that behind each person murdered, is a person with a name, with an identity, with a universe. As our sages tell us, if you save a single person, it is as if you have saved an entire universe. But if you kill a single person, it is as if you have murdered an entire universe. And so the abiding lesson which emerges from this first compelling principle of remembrance, that we are each, wherever we are, the guarantors of each other's destiny. As Milan Kundera, the Czech novelist, put it, speaking of this foundational principle of remembrance, when he spoke, as he put it, that the struggle of memory against forgetting is the struggle of freedom against tyranny. Which brings me to a second lesson, and I have to say, Paul, I got this lesson tonight when I picked up the, it was in my room as I walked in, there was a recent College of Law bulletin awaiting for me, and there was an interview with you, there was an interview with the dean as well, and I was struck in the interview by you saying that you were interested in some of the comparative approaches, let's say, to freedom of speech in the United States and in Canada. And this sort of inspired me to think about the second lesson, the compelling importance of the imperative of freedom of expression. A freedom of expression as being the lifeblood of democracy, as it has been called. Indeed, I'd have to say that the persecution and prosecution of every one of the political prisoners with whom I was associated began with their criminalization of their speech, began, in effect, with the criminalization of their innocence. But this is only one half of the story, and sometimes the second half is ignored and must be read together with the first. And the second part is the danger of state-sanctioned incitement to hate and genocide, and the danger also of incitement to hate in free and democratic societies themselves. Indeed, the enduring lesson of the Holocaust and the genocides that followed in Rwanda and Darfur is that these genocides occurred not simply because of the machinery of death, but because of state-sanctioned incitement to hate and to genocide. It is this teaching of contempt, this demonizing of the other, this is where it all begins. As the Supreme Court of Canada itself put it, the Holocaust did not begin in the gas chambers. It began, said the court, with words. These are the catastrophic effects of racism, said the court. These are the chilling facts of history. And this was supported by a recent important principle and precedent in the Muga Sera case, a judgment handed down by the Supreme Court in 2005, which held that the very incitement to genocide constitutes the crime in and of itself, whether or not acts of genocide in fact follow. And this, the Muga Sera case, was one that I was particularly engaged in because I was responsible as Minister of Justice and Attorney General for the prosecution of the case against Leon Muga Sera. And it's a fascinating case. Muga Sera had come to Canada from Rwanda in 1992. The dates are relevant here. And he sought refugee status. As more about his case emerged, it became clear that Leon Muga Sera had been engaged while in Rwanda in incitement to genocide. And when the proceedings began to shift from proceedings where he was seeking refugee status to proceedings with respect to his involvement in incitement to genocide, his defense was, well, look, I came to Canada in 1992. I sought refugee status in 1992. The genocide in Rwanda didn't take place until 1994. How can you hold me responsible when I was here in Canada when these acts were taking place? And that's when the court said that the very incitement to hate and genocide that you engaged in the early years in the 90s prior to the acts of genocide constituted a crime in and of itself, anchoring itself, as the court did, in the prohibition in the Genocide Convention against the direct and public incitement to genocide. See, the Genocide Convention does not only call for the prevention and punishment of acts of genocide. It calls for the prevention and punishment of incitement to genocide. And that's why the case in Canada is such an important principle and precedent in international terms. Yet regrettably, those who've been engaging in incitement to hate and genocide internationally have gone without any accountability before the law. I'll give you one example. The 21st century began on January 3rd, 2000, with the supreme leader of Iran, the Ayatollah Khamenei, saying that there can be no resolution to the Arab-Israeli conflict without the annihilation of the Jewish state. He did not even use the euphemism of the Zionist regime. This was repeated since, and we recall the period of Ahmadinejad, who became a main exponent of that state incitement to genocide. But people forget that all this was done under the leadership and sanction of the supreme leader, Khamenei. And I want to distinguish Khamenei's Iran from the people and publics of Iran who have otherwise been the targets of mass domestic repression. And I believe in that regard, we can celebrate today the return of Homa Hudfar to Canada after several brutal months in detention in Iran. But we should not ignore the fact that at the same time that she was finally permitted to leave, and I suspect that the Iranian regime did not want to experience another situation like happened with Mrs. Kazemi, who was tortured and then died in detention in Iran. And so there may have been some self-serving reasons as well for her release. But the point is, this should not obscure the fact that what we see in Iran today is a country that is engaged in more per capita executions of its citizens than any other country in the world, and continues to do so with impunity. And that under the regime of President Rouhani, the executions have proceeded at a rate double than that of his predecessor, even Ahmadinejad. And so I could go through a litany of that kind of state-sanctioned incitement to hate and repression in Iran. What concerns me is the fact that while we have legal remedies in international law, and I gave you the Mugesera case as a case study, which in effect means that such incitement to hatred and genocide and its combating is not simply a policy option. It is an obligation of states to combat and to prevent that. And yet, this continues to go unpunished, and the culture of impunity continues in Iran and elsewhere. Now, this convergence of freedom of speech on the one hand and the dangers of assault of speech in the other were also part of the interesting teachings that I had while I was a student at McGill Law School, and why I came to believe and to advocate that one can believe profoundly in the compelling imperative of freedom of speech as being the lifeblood of democracy, and that has underscored all my work in the defense of political prisoners, and yet at the same time be concerned and wish to hold accountable those engaged in state-sanctioned incitement to hate and those engaged in assault of hate speech in a free and democratic society. And I was exposed to the two exponents of those teachings by two law deans at McGill, Professor Frank Scott, who was involved not only in the teaching and writing about freedom of speech, as he put it, as the lifeblood of democracy, but involved in appellate review cases, Switzman and Ebling, which said at the time that liberty in these matters, i.e. freedom of speech, is no less vital to man's existence than breathing is to their physical existence. One of the most compelling statements about freedom of speech. My other law dean, Maxwell Cohn, who chaired the Special Commission on Hate Propaganda, warned against the dangers of hate and assault of speech. And after I graduated McGill, I went to Yale Law School, the home, Paul, as you know, of the American First Amendment, where it was said by many that all speech is protected speech. But one of those exponents of free speech at Yale Law School, who then became its dean, Dean Abraham Goldstein, said that not all speech is protected speech, even if my colleagues here at Yale continue to so assert it. Because even under the First Amendment, where it is held out that all speech is protected speech, as he put it, even under the First Amendment, there is no right to perjury. Perjury is not protected speech. There's no right with regard to child pornography. It's not protected speech. There's no right to misleading advertising. It's not, and one can go on. And in Canada, there is no right to engage in those particular excesses of hate speech, which take you down the road to assault of speech, which our courts have held in a trilogy of celebrated case law, in the Keekstra case, in the Smith and Andrews case, and the Taylor case, all of which were decided in that celebrated trilogy by the Supreme Court of Canada in 1990, where the courts at one and the same time asserted and celebrated the compellability of freedom of speech, but said nonetheless a line had to be drawn when that crossed the line into excesses of hate or assault of speech, because that then brought you also into a situation of being interlinked with equality rights. Because if you target minorities and make them the targets of hate speech over time, then this hate speech also becomes an equality rights issue. And this also brings in international protection concerns, where treaties to which Canada is a state party protect against incitement to hatred and discrimination. Which brings me now to a third lesson, and that is the one I spoke of at the outset, and that is the importance of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, which, as I said, has had a transformative impact not only on our laws, but on our lives. And where on the 10th anniversary of the Charter, the former Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, Chief Justice Antonio Lemaire, characterized the advent of the Charter as ushering in a legal revolution comparable to the discoveries of Pasteur in science. Now, even allowing for certain enthusiastic judicial rhetoric, there is no doubt that, in fact, this was a legal revolution. And the best appreciation of that legal revolution is looking at a snapshot of what life was like in Canada in pre-charter life and the law, which was, if one looks at it, a disturbing narrative in this country against and the marginalization of vulnerable groups, including discrimination against Aboriginal people, against racial and religious minorities, against women, against the disabled, against gays and lesbians, refugees, immigrants, and the like. Moreover, and this is something that is sometimes ignored, This disturbing narrative of discrimination often found expression in institutionalized discrimination against vulnerable groups in Canada so that they became historically disadvantaged groups. And such discrimination, as I've written elsewhere, was here in Canada very often state-sanctioned and even institutionalized as law. And so, if one looks at it from a juridical perspective, one will find that along with, and maybe because of this social history of discrimination, there was this juridical history of exclusion, the utter absence until the Charter came along of any constitutional right to equality, of any constitutional protection against discrimination, of the absence of constitutional remedies to redress the inquiry. In fact, as I said, we're not only on the eve of the 35th anniversary of the Charter, but the 105th anniversary of Confederation. But if we were to look at the first 115 years of Confederation, from 1867 to 1982 until the adoption of the Charter, what it would reveal would be a continuing preoccupation with the powers of government rather than the rights of people. In other words, traditional constitutional analysis and reform in Canada in the first 115 years revolved around the distribution of powers between the federal government and the provinces, otherwise known as legal federalism, rather than limitations on the exercise of power, otherwise known as civil liberties. And so it was that Professor Borelaskin, as he then was, went on to become Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Canada, put it at the time that in Canada, the question was, from a constitutional point of view, which of the two levels of government has the power to work the injustice, not whether the injustice itself can be prohibited. That this was the fallout, if you will, of a powers process as against a rights process. And then came the advent and the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And if you want to appreciate what Justice Antonio Lemaire said of this legal revolution, you have to appreciate that we moved from being a parliamentary democracy. The very enactment of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms as part of the Constitutional Act in 1982, its very enactment moved us from a parliamentary democracy to being a constitutional democracy, from the sovereignty of Parliament to the sovereignty of the Constitution, moving judges from being arbiters of legal federalism, which they still are, to also being guarantors of human rights, not because they sought that power, let alone not because they usurped that power, as critics sometimes claim, but because that power was vested in them by a parliamentary enactment, the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. And individuals and groups now had standing with respect to issues that now became justiciable with regard to certain claims and rights that would have been unthinkable and inconceivable in the pre-Charter era. But one also has to appreciate another important point, and this is something for which we as part of civil society have to take as an important, compelling lesson in terms of lessons learned and action to be taken. The Charter of Rights and Freedoms that we have is not, as it is sometimes spoken of, the Trudeau Charter of Rights and Freedoms, though admittedly former Prime Minister Pierre-Éliott Trudeau was the person who introduced and tabled the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. But what we ignore, and ignore at our peril, not only in terms of understanding the compellability of the Charter, but of the importance of civil society was that it was civil society in what has been called the year of the Constitution, 1980-1981, during the hearings of the Joint House-Senate Committee on the Constitution to consider the draft Charter of Rights and Freedoms, that transformed that charter into the people's package we now have. There's scarcely a section in the charter, as we know it today, that reads as it was when it was tabled. And as someone who was part of the Canadian Civil Liberties delegation at the time that came before the Joint House Committee, I still recall the headline on the front page in the newspapers the day after Sid McDanick, the then president, testified on behalf of the CCLA, when he said, "Thanks, but no thanks. If this is the charter you want to give us, we don't want this charter. And as a result of the interventions by the CCLA and others, the charter was transformed. I'll give you just several examples. The equality rights section in the charter is a section that owes its expression to the women in this country. And I want to pay tribute to the women's groups, because they came before the Joint House-Senate Committee and the Constitution, where Section 15 read in terms of equality before the law. And they said, no, we've been through this in the first 115 years. This didn't give us anything. And even though we now have it, we wanted to read equality before the law and under the law, and equal protection of the laws, and equal treatment of the laws, and the prohibition of discrimination. And then they identified all the categories of the prohibition of discrimination. And that's the Section 15 that you have today. And Section 15.2, which constitutionalizes affirmative action in this country, something that in America they have yet to achieve. And even with all that, the women were still concerned, well, maybe somehow the judges may not fully get the message. And so there's a section in the charter, not very well appreciated, that it's there. Section 28, because when we talk about the notwithstanding clause, everybody talks about how somehow governments have a residual power to introduce legislation notwithstanding the Charter of Rights. There is an express section that begins with the words notwithstanding, and that's Section 28, which says, notwithstanding anything in this act, men and women are equal in all respects. You don't find that in any other Charter of Rights anywhere. And that protection of equality rights in gender, in general, and specific gender equality in particular, resulted from the advocacy of women's groups and those associated with them. And another important section, Section 27, which said that the preservation and enhancement of our multicultural heritage is a constitutional norm in this country. Again, you don't find this in other charters. Or Section 11G, which says that an important section with regard to protecting against mass atrocity and bringing war criminals to justice, one that isn't always known that it's there as well, which says that in matters of war crimes, retroactivity shall not avail as a defense against prosecution where these crimes are criminal according to international law or according to the general principles of the law of nations. That also was not there in the initial charter. My point is, and concluding the point, that it was civil society in this country. It was the social groups in this country, the women's groups, the Aboriginal groups, who transformed the charter into the people's package that we have, rather than the one as it was originally tabled. And one final point that is not always appreciated, and that is in 1983, a group of peace groups, women's groups, Aboriginal groups came together to enjoin the testing of the cruise missile at the time on the grounds that this would be a threat to the life, liberty, and security of the person under Section 7 of the Charter. I have to make full disclosure, I was acting as counsel to those groups, but on the particular constitutional point that I'll get to in a moment. Ian Binney, who went on to become a member of the Supreme Court of Canada, but was then acting as an associate deputy minister for the government in this case, and a good friend of mine, but nonetheless characterized the action that we were taking as being frivolous, vexatious, and an abuse of process, and frankly called on the court to throw it out immediately in first instance. Well, because we had a rather eccentric judge, and maybe only because we had an eccentric judge, we won the case in the first instance, which was then characterized as the shot heard around the world and in the Kremlin itself. But the important point that took place, because on the way to the Supreme Court, of course, on the merits, we lost unanimously and the like. But what that case did and what the court otherwise held was that the Charter of Rights and Freedoms applied also to the executive branch of government, not just to acts of Parliament, federal or provincial. And here too, sometimes forgotten that this was not in the initial charter, and not even in the initial charter brought about by the civil society groups, as I mentioned, but this was part of the jurisprudence that also began to transform the scope and efficacy of the charter and had it apply to the executive power of government and not just to acts of Parliament, federal or provincial. And let me go now to the fourth and last principle on the domestic side. And this is a principle that really I found particularly compelling as a justice minister, and one that reminded me of the teachings I earlier alluded to. And that is that the test of a just society is how does it treat its most vulnerable people? How does it treat its poor, its disabled, its sick, its refugees, its violated women, its battered children, its Aboriginal people? Kinds of subject matter that will underpin the deliberations in this conference tomorrow and Saturday. And here I just want to very quickly single out three manifestations of action that we took or sought to take under this principle during the time that I was Minister of Justice and Attorney General, but where these challenges are continuing. The first has to do with the question of the protection of children. And here I want to say that the most important human rights lesson that I was ever taught was one taught to me by my daughter at the 15 years of age, when she said to me, "Daddy, if you want to know what the real test of human rights is all about, always ask yourself, at any time, in any situation, in any part of the world, is it good for children? Is what is happening good for children?" That's the real test of human rights, Daddy. And so it happened that the first piece of legislation I tabled as minister was called the Protection of Children and Other Vulnerable Persons, as Ralph Goodale might recall, was known amongst us as Gila's Law, inspired by my daughter at the time. The second legislation was the one that Ralph Goodale expressly referred to. That was the legislation regarding trafficking in persons, where trafficking was seen by us as being the contemporary global slave trade. And so we introduced the first law to combat trafficking in this country, organized around four principles. One, the prevention of trafficking. Two, the protection of its victims. Three, the prosecution of its perpetrators. And four, partnerships between government and civil society, domestically and internationally, in the prevention, combating, prosecution of perpetrators and protection of victims, what we called the four P's. So that was a trafficking initiative. And finally, and here I want to pay tribute to a person who, in my words, might well have been the greatest prime minister this country never had an opportunity to experience fully. And I'm speaking about Prime Minister Paul Martin because of his particular, among other things, commitment to Aboriginal rights, which has become his enduring mission for the last 10 years since he has no longer been the Prime Minister, but a hallmark of the kind of person he is and the commitments he has. And I recall here that at the first cabinet meeting we had, he said to us that we will be judged at the end of the day by what we do with respect to Aboriginal peoples. This, as he put it, is the legacy issue. There are no votes in this, but this will be the defining issue of our government. And so, as Minister of Justice at the time, I set forth an Aboriginal justice agenda, which was organized around what were called the 7 R's of Aboriginal justice, and very quickly and very briefly in that regard, each one of them deserves its own seminar. But the first was recognition of the Aboriginal people as the original inhabitants of this country. The second R was respect for their distinguishable constitutional status, also set forth Section 2535 of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms and the Constitution Act. The third was redress for past wrongs. The fourth R was representation in two senses. One, combating the overrepresentation of Aboriginal people in the criminal justice system, and the underrepresentation of Aboriginal people as judges, law enforcement officers, and the like. The fifth R was that of responsiveness, that when the government was making decisions, particularly in matters resource development and the like, then it had to be responsive to the claims and sensibilities of the Aboriginal people, things that in fact were laid down subsequently in court cases in this country. The sixth R was if we did the first five, we would arrive at reconciliation and would lead us to the last R, seven, the renewal of relationships between the government and the Aboriginal people. And let me close now by just making reference to the international justice agenda and the lessons here to be learned, and I'll only give two for reasons of time and then I'll close. Perhaps the most compelling lesson in a world today fraught with mass atrocity is the danger of indifference and inaction in the face of mass atrocity. What makes the Holocaust or the genocide in Rwanda, and we just commemorated a 22nd anniversary this summer of the genocide in Rwanda, where 1 million Rwandans, mostly ethnic Tutsis, some moderate Hutus among them, were murdered in a period of 3 months at a rate of 10,000 a day. And as I said, behind each person is a universe. But what makes the Rwandan genocide so horrific is not only the genocide itself, though that is horrific enough. What makes it so horrific is that this genocide was preventable. Nobody could say we did not know. We knew, but we did not act. Just as with regard to Darfur, we knew, but we did not act. Just as with regard to Syria, as we are meeting right now, the mass atrocities continue daily. We are now in the sixth year of war crimes and crimes against humanity that are being committed on a daily basis. I remember at the end of the first year, when, quote unquote, there were only 7,000 dead, when, quote unquote, there are only some 20,000 displaced. Now, as I'm speaking to you, there are more than 500,000 that have been killed. And there are more because the Human Rights Observatory stopped even being able to count for 2 years now, where some 12.5 million Syrians have been displaced from their homes with all the attending catastrophes that that entails, where 5 million have been refugees. And when we talk about the necessary inclusion and absorption and integration of refugees in our country, we must never ignore the fact that the refugees are the consequence, not the cause of the problems. The cause is the ongoing mass murder by the Syrian government and regime, supported by Russia and Iran, all of whom are engaged in these mass killings. And while we hear all about ISIS and Daesh, and we should, the mass killings began before ISIS and Daesh began their terrorist operations. And those of us who in 2012, at the end of 2012, were saying, look, this is a classic case of for the responsibility to intervene and protect. The doctrine which says, and we're now in the 11th anniversary of that doctrine, unanimously adopted by the UN Security Council in 2005, unanimously adopted before that by the General Assembly, which says that if in any country there are war crimes and crimes against humanity being committed, and the government of that country is unable or unwilling to do anything about it, or worse, as in the case of Syria, is the author of those war crimes and crimes against humanity, then it's the responsibility of the international community to intervene and protect the targeted innocent civilians. But those of us who were arguing that at the time and since were told, if you intervene, this will lead to civil strife, this will lead to civil war and sectarian warfare, this will lead to jihadists coming in. Everything we were told would happen if we intervened happened because we didn't intervene. The dangers, therefore, of indifference and inaction in the face of mass atrocity, the danger of being a bystander community as a government or a civil society, reminding us that one person, Raoul Wallenberg, saved more Jews in the Second World War in 6 months than any single government. It's a staggering datum, but happens to be the case. It tells you what one person, with the compassion to care and the courage to act, can confront evil and resist and transform history. You have to appreciate that in the months before Raoul Wallenberg arrived, from May to the beginning of July, 440,000 Hungarian Jews were deported to the death camps in Auschwitz, the fastest killing field in all of the Holocaust over that period. Wallenberg arrived in July and saved a remnant of Hungarian Jewry. And that's why, for all these reasons, we decided to establish a Raoul Wallenberg Center for Human Rights, an international consortium of parliamentarians, scholars, jurists, human rights defenders, NGOs, and students united in the pursuit of justice, inspired by and anchored in Wallenberg's humanitarian legacy. Wallenberg is, after all, our first honorary citizen, and who demonstrated, as I said, how one person can make a difference. And we have organized that center around four thematic projects. I'll only mention them. Time does not permit any elaboration. The first is Raoul Wallenberg, Hero of Humanity, Acts of Remembrance, Remembrance to Act. Under that, we've established a number of initiatives, which include a Raoul Wallenberg Lectureship in Human Rights at McGill University. I even commend this possible initiative here at the University of Saskatchewan. As I say, he is an honorary citizen of Canada. Other initiatives in that regard are those that were initiated by the Parliament of Canada itself, even before this center was set up and which inspired it, and that is declaring January 17th as Raoul Wallenberg a Day in Canada and inviting Canadians to learn about, reflect upon, and act on his humanitarian legacy. The second theme is the Holocaust, genocide, and human rights, universal lessons for the prevention and combating of mass atrocity in our time. There are some 10 lessons. They include some of those that I mentioned this evening. The dangers, for example, of state sanction, incitement to hate and genocide, responsibility to prevent, the dangers of indifference and inaction in the face of mass atrocity, the responsibility to protect, the danger of a culture of impunity, the responsibility to bring war criminals to justice, etc. The third objective is promoting human dignity, combating racism, hatred, anti-Semitism, violent extremism, and terrorism. And to that end, given some of the themes I mentioned, we held this past May in Krakow at Jagiellonia University in Poland a seminar, because it's the 80th anniversary, as I mentioned, of the double entendre of Nuremberg. The Nuremberg of hate, 80th anniversary of the Nuremberg race laws, and the Nuremberg of judgments, because it's also now the 70th anniversary of the Nuremberg trials. And we adopted a never again declaration, which I commend to this College of Law and this university for your consideration and support. And finally, the fourth thing is defending political prisoners, because Wallenberg, at the end of the day, ended up being himself a political prisoner in the Soviet Gulag, and the mystery of what happened to him remains. And as I'm speaking to you, his family has, and scholars have just returned from Moscow in yet another attempt to try to determine the fate of what happened to Raoul Wallenberg. You see, the Soviets and then the Russians have continued to claim first that he died of a heart attack on January 17th, 1947, something that was seemed almost impossible to all who knew Wallenberg, a person not only in health, but all his brothers and sisters have lived close to the age of 100. So it was unlikely that he might have died of a heart attack at the age of 33. When the Soviets realized that this might not work, they changed it to, he didn't die of a heart attack. He was executed. The internal contradiction somehow did not seem to disturb them. But they have never answered any of the questions of those of us who have brought up compelling witness testimony and documentary evidence that Wallenberg was alive and seen after July 17th, 1947, the date in which he was alleged to either have died of a heart attack or subsequently to have been executed. And I'll give you one example of a compelling riposte to the Soviet-Russian story. In 1990, I was part of a group that went to Vladimir prison, where there had been presumed sightings of Wallenberg over the years by inmates there. One of the inmates who had been with Wallenberg and was with us at that time was Marvin Makinen. But one of the most compelling things that we discovered was that the Soviets and the Russians, who claimed that they had made an exhaustive search about the fate of Raoul Wallenberg, had never visited Vladimir prison, had never questioned any of the witnesses there, had never spoken to the doctor who claimed to have administered to, et cetera, et cetera. In other words, in legal terms, they were frankly stopped from making any allegation simply because they had never made any investigation. And it's not surprising that a U.S. court in 1985, in a case of Guy von Dardel and the USSR, Guy von Dardel being Wallenberg's brother, held that the evidence was, and I'm quoting the words of the court, incontrovertible, that Wallenberg did not die in 1947 as the Soviets and then Russians claim he did, And the mystery remains, even though a New York Times article suggested a month ago that the mystery had been solved by the discovery of the diaries of a former head of the KGB, which stated to the effect that Wallenberg had been executed in 1947. And since we live in a very ahistorical universe, the New York Times printed the article as if this was the first time that this allegation had been made, not realizing that this allegation was yet another restatement of the same false allegations that had been repeated over time, and that we still owe Wallenberg the justice of determining what his fate was. The person who saved so many was regrettably not saved by so many who could, and regrettably never found out the truth by so many who could. And so let me close by returning to where I said at the beginning, that if we want to pursue justice, we have to understand and we have to feel the injustice about us. And while not everybody can be a Raoul Wallenberg, pursuing justice, combating injustice, just means doing so on a daily basis, each one of us in our own modest way. It may be in saying a kind word to a person who may be ill. It may be the visiting of the sick. It may be the defending of political prisoners. As the sage Maimonides put it, that we should each see the world as being divided into half evil and half good. Therefore, one good deed by any one of us on any given day, at any given moment in time, can transform the universe from evil to good. And so we have, each one of us, in our own capacity, the ability to have a cosmic impact and to every day pursue justice by combating injustice. Thank you.
Thank you. There's really not much else to say after that, but thank you. Thank you for teaching us, thank you for enlightening us, and thank you for coming here to share all of this with us. Starting tomorrow morning, the law school will spend a day and a half talking about all of these issues and many more. Irwin will be on a program tomorrow morning, late in the morning, talking about political and human rights prisoners around the world. And at least one of the people who Irwin helped rescue from Iran will be on the program with him. I urge all of you to come tomorrow to the law school, and on Saturday morning to come to the law school. We will be covering a wide range of topics, far too many to go into tonight. If you are interested in what's going on, among other things, you could, of course, go to the law school's website, because all things live on websites. Right now, you are all invited to proceed out the door and turn left, and there will be some faculty members and some members of the law school staff who will be leading the way to the faculty club, where we will be having a reception in Irwin's honor, sponsored by the Center for Israel and Jewish Affairs, known as CEJA, a nonprofit humanitarian organization based in Canada that combats discrimination and anti-Semitism in all its forms. And I think what we've heard tonight reminds us of the first article of the UN Declaration of Human Rights, which said that we should combat and end slavery in all its forms. And we should simply add to that that we must continue to fight discrimination, racism, anti-Semitism, religious discrimination, bigotry, hatred in all its forms. And Irwin has been doing that all his life. And now let's go toast him next door. Thank you all.